Hello everybody, I welcome you all in this new edition of news coverage and analysis from the Hindu newspaper dated 4th March 2019. So what all are we going to cover is detailed here in these two slides. You can pause the video and note down if you wish. So let's start with the first article. It says ILNFS ignored risk assessment reports while extending loans. The important point is what's called the negative spread. Company extended a loan at a negative spread to borrowing facing liquidity issue. A negative spread, the important point here for you to note, a negative spread occurs when the interest rates charged on an amount lent are lower than the interest rate paid on borrowing that sum. So say ILFS has extended a loan to a company, say X. So if it has charged or it is going to charge 4%, but if ILFS has sourced that fund, say from RBI or some other foreign investor or whosoever, at 5%, then there is a negative spread of 1%, and that's what this article is talking about, or this is what the expert or the auditors have pointed out in the case of ILNFS. Now the second article is gearing up for Cardiff with a hope and a ball. What is important here is to know what is called Homeless World Cup. The news is since 2006, India has been fielding teams at Homeless World Cup, which began in 2003, thanks to the effort of the Nagpur-based NGO Slum Soccer. The movement, which is spread over 70 countries, used football as an inspiration for homeless people to change their lives. Of course, there are no prize for guessing. The most crowned winner in this form of the game is again Brazil. Now, what is this Homeless World Cup? It is an annual football tournament organized by the Homeless World Cup Foundation, a social organization which advocates the end of homeless through the effort of association football. The organization puts together an annual football tournament where teams of the homeless people from each country compete. The Homeless World Cup organization was co-founded by Mel Young and Harald Smeed in 2001 to advocate for a global solution for homelessness. The first annual football tournament for homeless people took place in 2003 in Graz, Austria. So you should remember this fact for your prelims examination. Now the next article at page 5, there are a couple of articles there and I have just pointed out important facts. The first is Vidyal heralds a new dawn. The important point is Periyar Tiger Reserve, that is in Kerala, that you should remember for your prelims. Monkey fever toll in Shivamogga district 12. Now important point here is Kayasanur forest disease or KFD is a tick-borne viral hemorrhagic fever endemic, and this is also called as a monkey fever. To South India, the disease is caused by a virus belonging to the family of flaviviride, which also includes yellow fever and dengue fever. So these are the facts that you should remember. The next article is Will Malgudi figure on a rail map? Well, this is an interesting article, and that's why I have just taken the note of it. B.Y. Raghavendra, MP of the Shivamogga, has sent a proposal of renaming Arasalu station in the district of as a Malgudi station. You must be knowing that Malgudi is a fictitious place, and now people are trying to name a particular place as Malgudi. There is a train also called the Malgudi Express, and that runs between Mysuru and Yeshwantpur. Now, fish trouble. A traditional fisherman is trying his luck at the coal wetland in Thrissur. That you should remember, there is a coal wetland in Thrissur, Kerala. Now the next article is Andhra Pradesh villagers yearn to revive historic temple. Mottupalli, where a historic temple of Virbhadra Swami A fiery form of Lord Shiva is located, has been an important part of the century with flourishing trade with South Asian countries, especially during the medieval period. The temple, constructed during the regime of Cholas, is an Indologist delight with stone inscriptions in Telugu, Tamil, and awe-inspiring Panch Loha idols. So all the facts here are important for you from culture point of view. Now, next article, Bengal committed to protect wildlife. Important point here is World Wildlife Day is 3rd March. Now at pace 7, Rajdhani Express turns 50. You must remember this, that the first Rajdhani Express ran from Howrah in Eastern Railway to New Delhi on 3rd March 1969. Now the next article is a tale of 6 elephants using one corridor in 2 countries. Couple of important points here. In a publication titled The Importance of Transboundary Conservation of the Asiatic Elephant, Elephas Maximus in Patharia Hills Reserve Forest, you should remember this, where exactly is this located, I'll tell you in an infograph, northeastern India. Scientists have called for joint conservation activity for the protection of the herd. The paper was published in the journal 310 Taxa. During the summer, from April to July, the elephants stay in Bangladesh, while in winter, from November to December, they prefer to remain in the forest patches and tea states of Indian side. Well, in case you remember, a couple of days we had covered an article in which to save one horn rhino, there was a meeting between the representative of India, Nepal, Bhutan and Bangladesh, and similar is the approach of this particular article or the paper that is published, that India and Bangladesh should cooperate for conservation. I mean, they should give corridor. So there should be a corridor between India and Bangladesh for elephants. So here is the Patharia Hills Reserve, and this is located somewhere here, or you can see here. So that you should remember. Now we come to the editorial at page 8. The basics are vital. What author is emphasizing? Making hospitalization effort will naturally spell relief, but there is no alternative to strengthening primary health care. Now he's trying to build his argument by saying that in 2011, a high level expert group on universal health coverage reckoned that nearly 70% of the government health spending should go to the primary health care. The National Health Policy 2017 also advocated allocating resource of up to 2/3 or more to primary care, as it enunciated the goal of achieving the highest possible level of good health and well-being through a preventive and promotive healthcare orientation. So basically, our author is saying that government should focus on strengthening primary healthcare sector, and he has cited the report or the suggestion of expert group first of 2011 and then National Health Policy 2017, and both have talked about promoting the primary health care. Now what is the ground reality? Before getting into what government is doing, author has tried to emphasize on what is the ground reality and how exactly is it moving forward. Today, the condition of our primary health infrastructure is lamentable. Why? There is a shortage of PHCs, primary health care centers, 22%, and sub-health center 20%, while only 7% health centers and 12% primary health centers meet the Indian public health standard norms. So, primary health center 22%, sub-health center 20%, out of which only 7% of the health sub-health center and 12% of the primary health centers meet the public health standard norms. So basically, author is trying to say that first we have a shortage, 22% shortage in PHC, then there is a 20% shortage in sub-health centers, and then, I mean, if your sub-health centers are only 80% of your requirement, out of which only 7% meet the standard. So such is the deplorable condition. And similar is the case with primary health care center. Only 12% of already deficient system meet the norms of public health center standards. Now, what the author is saying that the expert committee is suggesting something else, government at the ground level is doing something else, or maybe the way I feel that government has taken a short term and a long term view. First, a healthcare center. Government has emphasized to promote healthcare center as a wellness center and has been allocating fund. So let's see what government is doing. Last year, an outlay of 1200 crores was proposed to transform 1.5 lakh sub health center into a health and wellness center by 2022. Quite an important fact for you, which would provide a wide range of primary healthcare services than existing sub and primary healthcare center. Now here the author is criticizing that going by the government's own estimate in 2017, it would cost 16 lakhs to convert a sub health center into a health and wellness center. 1500 centers are to be converted each year and 8 lakhs are required to run one health center. That is as per the estimate of the government only. Now, what is the allocation? This year, the outlay of 1600 crores, a 33% increase from previous year, clubbed under the National Health Mission budget. The required sum for the year 1920 stands at around 3600 crore. The allocation is 1600 crores, requirement is 3600 crore. How? 2400 crore would be required for the creation or upgradation of sub healthcare center into wellness center, and another 1200 crores is required for running that. 16 lakhs is to convert and 8 lakhs is to run that center. So nearly 24 lakhs per year is required to first upgrade and then to run that sub healthcare center into a health and wellness center. So while this is a conservative estimate, the realistic figure would not be less than 4500 crore, and the kind of money that is allocated, government would not be able to achieve 50% of its goal. You can make the calculation and see. Now, second, that's what the author is criticizing, that although government is taking a step, that but then probably it's not in the in its scheme of things. Now, government is taking another totally divergent step. That's what author feels, that NHM, that is National Health Mission, India's flagship health program, share in the health budget fell from 73% in 2006 to 50% in 2019 in the absence of uniform and substantial increase in the health spending by states. So here author is saying that probably it is falling out of favor from government. The medium-term expenditure projection estimates that presented by Ministry of Finance to Parliament in August 2018 projected a 17% increase in the allocation for National Health Mission in 1920. However, there has only been an increase of 3.4% this year. So projected was something else as per the demand, but actual increase is meager 3.4%. With this, the National Health Mission budget for the year 31,745 crore barely crossed the actual spending of the program in 17-18, that is 31,510 crore. But the center looks fairly committed to increase the access of hospitalization care. Now here author is quite confused, or probably is not in consonance with the aim of the government. Although author is praising and saying that central government's commitment towards saving people from hospitalization costs is commendable, but the focus probably is lacking, and which should have been the upgradation of healthcare centers. So let's see what author is saying. But the center looks quite committed to increase the access to hospitalization care predominantly through the private player, and this is reflected in 167% increase in the allocation this year for Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, the insurance program which aims to cover 10 crore poor family for hospitalization expenses of up to 5 lakhs per family per annum. That you must be knowing. And government's recent step in incentivize the private sector to open hospitals in tier 2 and tier 3 cities. The increase in the Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana budget is a welcome step. Spending on this colossal insurance program will need to rise considerably with every passing year so that its commitments can be made. Now here there is one important program. You have started a program which proposes to cover the wider mass, that means 10 crore poor family. So, and you are giving an insurance cover, hospitalization cost cover, insurance cover of 5 lakh per family per annum. So that way, and this is not going to come down, this is going to increase. And that's why the author is saying that probably government is not focused on what exactly it wants to do. But the way I feel that probably these two programs are in consonance with each other, and government has devised a short-term and a long-term goal. So these are the long-term goal and these are the short-term goal. Why these are short-term? First, you need to make your make masses healthy, or you should first try to protect them from exorbitant cost on that is incurred during hospitalization. And then slowly you can build your infrastructure by converting sub healthcare center into health and wellness center. And that will take time because it not only requires upgradation of infrastructure but also needs a system which actually takes time in developing. So that's the way I feel. You got to analyze on this on your own and then you can form your own opinion. However, author here feels that both are totally divergent thing and government should have focus on this than going on this. However, my opinion is totally different. I feel that both should run and definitely focus should be first on this and second on this, and this is a short-term measure and this should be a long-term measure. Now, what is author's suggestion? While making hospitalization affordable brings readily noticeable relief, there is no alternative to strengthening primary healthcare center in the pursuit of an effective and efficient healthcare system. It must be remembered that the achievement of a distress-free and comprehensive wellness system for all, government's hope hinge on a performance of a health and wellness center, as they will be instrumental in reducing the greater burden of out-of-pocket expenditure on health. And that's what I have been focusing, that government is trying to pitch in private sector so that first this distress should be taken care of, that is reducing the greater burden of out-of-pocket expenditure on health. This should be first addressed, and then at the long term this program can very well shift to strengthening or relying on primary healthcare center. And when this becomes primary healthcare center becomes reliable, then automatically cost on this would come down. So author further says that their role shall be critical in the medium and long term to ensure a success of and sustainability of the Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, that is insurance scheme. As a weaker primary healthcare system will only increase the burden of hospitalization. Apart from an adequate emphasis on primary healthcare center, there is a need to depart from current trend of erratic and insufficient increase in the health spending and make substantial and sustained investment in public health over the next decade. Without this, the ninth dimension, that is the healthy India of Vision 2030, will remain unfulfilled. Quite an interesting article. You should read this article and form your own opinion. The way I see it, and I would recommend to look at that, government definitely wants to improve upon the infrastructure of the healthcare centers. However, in a short term, government is focusing on reducing the burden of the masses by providing them a health insurance scheme so that there is a lesser burden on out of pocket expenditure. And then when in long term, this primary healthcare center or the wellness center graduates to a better service providing centers, then the burden of government on expenditure related to health insurance would definitely come down, and that can be shifted on the on providing better facility. Now, next article is failing the forest. The argument here is both human rights and the wildlife right groups. These are the two groups who are fighting in Supreme Court, and because of that, there was a verdict from Supreme Court that immediately whosoever could not establish their claim should be evicted from the forest land, and then on the intervention or the appeal filed by the government of India, the stay was issued by Supreme Court. So these are the two parties. First is human rights group, and then there is a wildlife rights group. And the article says that both human rights and the wildlife right group have not used the Forest Right Act as a conservation tool, and that's the basic premise. And what is the analysis? The author says that while the Supreme Court has now made it clear that there will be no forcible eviction, what the order has succeeded in doing is resuscitating a sharp binary between the human rights and the wildlife right based group that have for decades tried to swing public opinion in their own favor. So what are the two opinion? First opinion, the wildlife group is having, that the wildlife group who went to court argue that the implementation of Forest Right Act could lead to encroachment and fresh clearance of forest land for human dwelling. So what these people are saying, that those who could not establish their claim are outsider, and they are there as, you know, they have encroached upon, and they would be clearing forest land for their own vested motive, either for establishing factory or basically they would destroy the forest. And then there is a second party, which is human rights group, and they have argued that Forest Right Act was passed by parliament and is aimed at correcting the historical injustice, and to whom? To traditional other traditional forest dwellers. So there were two parties, in case you remember, in Forest Right Act. It says that the claim of scheduled tribe and other traditional forest dwellers would be established by a three-tier system, that and the bottom tier or the level who would recognize the claim would be Gram Panchayat. So it is saying that it is aimed at correcting the historical injustice to traditional forest dwellers. So their main party to whom they are supporting is other traditional forest dwellers, who since colonial time have been subjected to a cycle of eviction. So they have been evicted from one place to another because of this recurrent developmental projects. Since colonial times, as government asserted their control over forest, India's forest history has become a cycle of eviction from forest land and rebellion by forest dwellers. So where these groups are failing, that's why the author has tried to explain. So none seemingly is focusing on the core issue, and that is forest. That's what the author is saying, that they are not, probably they have missed their focus, that the focus point should have been forest, but probably they are focusing more on people who are staying and whether their claim is there or not. So ideally their focus area should have been the conservation of forest or a spread of forest, but that is lacking. The author saying that the FRA was meant for forest dwellers, but it could have also been a powerful tool for conservation. Sadly, both sides have propagated misinformation to garner support for themselves. The first myth that needs to be busted for the wildlife lobby is that when a right recognized of a forest dweller or Adivasi on a piece of land, it does not mean that he or she will cut down all the trees in that area. So this is the main point that author is trying to explain to wildlife lobby, that since these people are after those group who could not establish their claim, and their main contention is that these people would destroy forest land. And what author is saying that in case you accept the claim of other traditional forest dweller, that does not mean that they would be destroying trees in that area. To argue that the right of the million of the forest dwellers have been recognized through the act does not mean that the forest is a pie to be divided. And that's an important point to understand. If you have accepted somebody's claim, does not mean that the forest land becomes a pie that is to be divided. So the author is saying that when forest land is divided or diverted for big development project like mining or highways or road, it is actually clear felt or submerged. If this fundamental difference between the recognition of right and diversion were accepted, the groups at the loggerhead would in fact find ground for commonality. So basically saying that when what happens when this lands are diverted for big projects, so that time nobody says that whose rights were more hampered. So basically both groups are going to get affected by this. So basically, to quote an example and to explain the situation, he has given a quote of an author has quoted an example of Honorable Supreme Court, when in one case Supreme Court had asked Gram Sabha to decide the matter of Vedanta's bauxite project, and Gram Sabha at that time unanimously had rejected the mining in the hills. So basically, by quoting this example, author is trying to say that other forest dwellers are no different from scheduled tribes staying in that area. Had that not been the case, probably there would have been a fractured mandate. But in Vedanta's bauxite project case, and Supreme Court also recognized that. That's why Supreme Court passed on the merit of the case to be decided by the Gram Sabha. Had Supreme Court not been convinced about that fact, it would have given decision on its own. But rather, Supreme Court decided to pass the authority to the Gram Sabha, and as the to satisfy or to Gram Sabha live up to the expectation of Supreme Court, they unanimously rejected the project. So that by showing this example, author is trying to say that the scheduled tribes or the forest dwellers and other traditional forest dwellers are no different. They both are committed towards the protection of forest land or the forest. He further says that again in 2016, it was the FRA that was invoked by the National Green Tribunal NGT when the people of the Lipa in Himachal Pradesh were given the power to decide whether or not they wanted a hydel power project in that area. The project would have led to the submergence of forest land and also caused heavy siltation in the river. So this is the second example that not only Supreme Court but also NGT invoked FRA, Forest Rights Act, and asked forest dwellers of that area to decide about the project. And as expected, those forest dwellers rejected the claim. So that means they both these parties are no different. So when wildlife groups point towards the thousands of bogus claims that are being filed and that should be rejected, what should not go unnoticed is that the state in fact is not always keen on recognizing the rights of the people in the forest area, even if it may get them vote, as it becomes tough to divert land for big projects. Now here quite an interesting point that author is saying that probably state is also in connivance with this group. Because state is not also taking its active part into the recognizing of right candidate, because probably state feels that it will become tougher for states to get land for big projects, because in that situation those forest dwellers and other forest dwellers would actually oppose the project. And there are example also in Mapithel Dam in Manipur. To obtain forest clearance, the state government would have to prove that the right of the tribal people and the forest dweller would not be affected. However, the state government refused to recognize the right of the people living there, since it was keen to construct the dam. So this author is also trying to say that at times state also plays plays mala fide or act by mala fide intention. Here in this Mapithel dam area, state completely refused or to recognize the right of the people living in that area, and by doing that it could easily claim the land for the dam project. Had it recognized the claim of people residing in that area, it would have been asked to take their clearance, and that would have been really a tough case. So basically saying that these two parties should come together to understand that they are not fighting for two different parties. Rather, their focus area should have been forest rather than two different set of people. So what these groups or NGOs should do? Could not the same wildlife NGO which has filed the petition in the Supreme Court have joined hand with the local community and use FRA to challenge big development project coming up on forest land instead? Human rights group too cannot be absolved of blame. Most of them have been quick to respond when the judiciary stepped in, but have been missing when it came to the tedious groundwork of working with the Gram Sabhas and ensuring their genuine claims are filed. So basically, author is saying that they also are culprit. Ideally, rather than going to Supreme Court and fighting the case, had these people gone to Gram Sabhas to ensure that the genuine claims are filed, this case would not have escalated and wasted so much of time and energy. So ideally, what they should do, they should go to those areas and work with Gram Sabhas to ensure that genuine claims are accepted. But then this is a tedious task, and actually author is blaming that these people probably are not interested in exerting so much. The same human rights group did not come forward to fight case that could have helped conservation as well as the people who live in this area. So both group have failed the forest, and that's what author concludes. Now, bottom of the job pyramid, quite an interesting one. Data from 2011 census show that the proportion of SCSTs workers in low paying non farm job were relatively high compared to their share in high income profile. A state wise analysis is presented here. What is important here to see what is the status in those states where population of scheduled caste or scheduled tribes are relatively low. So let's see what is the case in Punjab. Punjab, in high paying job, only 16% are participating, while in low paying job, 40.58% people are involved. So the position of scheduled caste and scheduled tribes are deplorable in Punjab. Now let's see what is the case in Haryana. It is even worse. 8.98% are in high paying and 27.69% in low paying job, quite expected. Similar is the case with Delhi. MP is the same, no different. Rajasthan is the same, and Himachal Pradesh also is the same. So basically, in a nutshell, what you can understand that the area where the population of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes are less, they are more exploited. And you can contrast it with northeastern state. If you see Manipur, in low paying job they are 30.67%, in high paying job they are 65.18%. Mizoram is doing quite good, 87% and 94.5%, because those areas are traditionally scheduled tribe areas. So exploitation is more in the hinterland, in Hindi belt, where the population are of scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, as a percentage of the population are less. Now at page 11, UK offers collaboration in fighter tech and careers. Well, this article may not be that important directly, but it is quite useful for your forming an opinion and forming your view about geopolitics. So you can, you know, straight away understand that UK is interested in taking a pie on government or India's you know, defense allocation. Furthermore, you can also very well conclude that probably India is going to invest more on defense sector. As the Indian Air Force continues its effort to procure new fighter jets, the UK has made a pitch for cooperation in the field of building aircraft carrier and future fighter aircraft technology. As part of air combat strategy, BAE system has begun Tempest project to develop sixth generation stealth fighter to replace Typhoon in service in the Royal Air Force, and are scheduled to be phased out by 2040. So you know, Eurofighter Typhoon is also a contender for MMRCA contract that is floated by Indian Air Force for 114 MMRCA. Since BA, I mean UK itself is going to phase it out by 2040, what is the point in buying or considering Eurofighter Typhoon? Because within 20 years it will be obsolete. Well, at page 12, SpaceX capsule docks on ISS. SpaceX new Dragon capsule, this is important for your pre, successfully docked on International Space Station ISS on Sunday. NASA and SpaceX confirmed during a live broadcast. Space shuttle program is important. Question may be asked to you in pre. The first orbiter Enterprise was built in 1976, used in approach and landing test, and had no orbital capacity. Four fully operational orbiters were initially built as Columbia, Challenger, Discovery, and Atlantis. Of these, two were lost in mission accidents, Challenger in 1986, Columbia in 2003, with a total 14 astronauts were killed. A fifth operational and the sixth in total orbiter Endeavour was built in 1991 to replace Challenger. The space shuttle was retired from service upon the conclusion of Atlantis' final flight on July 21, 2011. The US has since relied on Russia's Soyuz spacecraft to transport astronaut to the International Space Station. So these are the important facts that you should remember that I have included, that is not there in the article. Now, as at page 13, trends of recycling gold by retail users on the rise. Quite an important point, and this is important to form your own perspective about dynamics of Indian economy. The quantum of recycled gold in the system is on the rise in India on account of an increase in gold prices and some players ensuring transparency in evaluation and pricing, said the jeweler and gold loan companies. This trend is also helping curb import, thus saving foreign exchange. India is the second largest consumer of gold and the largest importer of yellow metal, that is gold, importing about 700 to 800 tons annually. This has a bearing on India's current account deficit. In 2017-18, India's gold import increased by 22.3% to $33.65 billion, and current account deficit jumped to $48.7 billion, or you can say 1.9% of GDP. All these facts are important for you. Now, the next article is Niti Aayog to draw up list of non-core asset of CPSEs for monetization. I don't understand. Whenever this BJP government comes, they start selling land and infrastructure. I remember in 2004, 2000 to 2004, Ashoka Hotel of Delhi was sold for or given on lease for meager 90 crore rupees or something. I mean, even the land cost of Ashoka Hotel would have been much, much more than that. But anyway, let's come back to the article. The Niti Aayog has been tasked with the drawing up of list of non-core asset of various CPSEs, both healthy and sick ones, as a first step towards finance minister's plan to monetize such asset and unlock value of shareholder. I don't know which shareholder is getting benefited out of it. This is a part of overall plan of the government to lay down a procedure and mechanism for monetization of non-core asset of central and public sector undertaking that includes mainly land and building. So private sector could come and grab the prime land and building of governments. Wow. Niti Aayog will drop the list of non-core asset owned by CPSEs, which can be sold separately after discussion with the consultative group comprising of official from administrative ministries, Department of Economic Affairs, Department of Investment and Public Asset Management, DIPM. This name you should remember. This might be asked in prelims. Now, this is an interview, and this is quite an interesting one. So you should read this interview. This is an interview of the MD of the company, that is Energy Efficiency Services Limited, and I have taken some of the questions for your understanding. This will help you form your opinion towards aim and action taken by Government of India towards achieving sustainable development or in terms of energy efficiency. So what does it say? In the entire growth of Energy Efficiency Services Limited coming from LED lighting alone, this is the question that is asked. And the answer is, it has been a very rapid growth both in terms of value and volume and also in terms of diversification. 4 years ago, we were just into a couple of vertical likes LED lighting and domestic and public uses. But now there are many initiatives that we have started. While lighting remains strong portfolio, we have got into building electric mobility, smart meters and decentralized solar plants. So this is what the portfolio of Energy Efficiency Services Limited. It's not only LED lighting but also smart buildings, electric mobility, smart meters and decentralized solar power plant. In case any question is asked about Energy Efficiency Services Limited and its portfolio, you should be able to answer. Next question is, what's EESL's biggest achievement so far? Ujala was the LED bulb program. This also is important, you should remember. When we started the program in 2014, a 7 watt LED bulb cost 310 and now it costs only 72 rupees. We are procuring a far more efficient 9 watt bulb for rupees 40 and we have distributed 32 crore bulbs over last 4 years giving LED at 72 rupees. So we are a market enabler. 116 crore bulbs is done by the private sector. All these data are quite important for your mains. And these facts are important for your pre also. We have done market transformation in the lighting sector by saving 8,300 megawatt of power capacity by LED lighting. That again is an important fact. Next question is, how much have you invested in energy efficiency so far against the target of 74,000 crore? So our investment till now in energy efficiency and energy efficiency products already deployed and committed is 10,000 crore. So they are quite lagging as compared to 74,000 crore of target. They have achieved only 10,000 crore. So of course, we are very far away from the figure, which has now doubled to 1.5 lakh crore. So this is now the new target of Government of India. Investment in energy efficiency is pegged at 1.5 lakh crore. A large part of this is done by industry on its own. For example, there is a scheme called Perform, Achieve and Trade, a regulatory scheme of Bureau of Energy Efficiency. This is important for your pre and mains both. In the first cycle, the industry has invested 25,000 crore to reduce their energy consumption. The second and expected investment is 35,000 crore. Most players do it for themselves, but we do it for others as well. All these steps are important for your mains. So what's happening in the electric vehicle space? The role of government will be that of enabler. The power ministry has come out with two guidelines that charging is not a sale. This you should remember. Charging is not a sale or resale of power, but a service. So that means charging service center now can be open, or there might be, some rules and regulation coming or must have issued. We'll have to check. I have not checked yet. It has capped what a distribution company can charge an EV charging station, and it has also clarified what kind of charging infrastructure you need to have in charging station. So that means there is some rule or there is some guidelines issued by Government of India. With this, the basic policy framework is there. We have started settling public charging infrastructure in New Delhi municipal area. Important point. Some other entities are also seen tying up with DISCOMs and municipal bodies for public charging. In India, besides Tata and Mahindra, I know three more OEMs, that is Hyundai, Nissan, Kia Motors, are coming out with their electric vehicles. So now we can expect public charging stations and more electric vehicles on the road. Now at page 14, India's electric vehicle success story will ride on two wheels. Quite an interesting one. I mean, this should quite help you. In the year 2018, was the year for electrics. Cumulative electric vehicle on road crossed 4 million mark, and the Tesla 3 motor became the best selling premium vehicle that we all are aware of, delivering over 140,000 vehicles in a year. Quite a commendable one. According to the latest global electric vehicle outlook published by International Energy Agency, that this you should remember, China has around 250 million electric two-wheeler with annual sale of 30 million. Outstanding. This program appears extremely promising as there are close to a billion two-wheeler in circulation in association of South Asian nations, China and India. So we have a billion of two-wheeler. So if you want to replace it, then China is leading. However, electric two-wheeler adoption is almost exclusively limited to China, the way I said. As highlighted in an article by Akshat Rathi in Quartz, of the total carbon dioxide emission saved by EV worldwide, over 80% was due to China's electric two-wheeler alone. So China has taken quite a few steps and quite an important one. This raises an interesting question of what makes China different from its neighbor country in Asia. And there are two factors that are highlighted for this success story in China. First is electric two-wheeler were designed as bicycle, exempted from all kind of registration and requiring a driving license. And cities places severe limitation on the use of petrol two-wheelers in the city center. So people would be forced to buy electric two-wheelers for their daily commute. So very good step taken by China. Now further, in order to write an EV success story in India, it is very important to electrify two-wheelers, which are about 3/4 of the transportation fleet in India. As noticed by Amitabh Kant, CEO of Niti Aayog. He also detailed that by electrifying all the two-wheeler in use, India can avoid about 15% of the total transportation emission, and more importantly, about 30% of the particulate matter, curbing air pollution. This is what CEO of Niti Aayog is saying. So now what limits the conversion of two-wheeler in EVs? Let's try to see. So what are the favorable factor for changing to two-wheeler in EV segment? First is, in the real world, a conversion or conventional scooter mileage is about 50 to 70 kilometers for a liter of petrol, which can be interpreted to be about 135 to 190 watt hour for every kilometer. That is 1000 watt hour is the one unit of monthly electricity bill that you all know. On the other hand, if the same scooter is electric, then it would need about 25 to 40 watt hour, equivalent to running a modern LED tube light for about 2 hours. The electric scooter is around 4 to 6 times more efficient than the petrol scooter. You can very well correlate from these two para. Now, batteries and electric motors are much efficient than the petrol engine. And by regenerative braking, that is running the motor in reverse, the scooters can store energy back into the battery pack during braking. So basically, regenerative braking is that, you are accelerating and suddenly now you have to brake. So the moment you apply the brake, the motor of your electric scooter or the electric vehicle changes into a dynamo. So it start producing, so its poles are actually reversed the moment you apply the brake. So your rotor becomes stator and stator becomes rotor by action. So that way it start generating electricity, and it happens with induction motor. So the moment it starts generating electricity, where would it go? So it will start charging the battery. So that way it starts saving energy. And in fact, in case you remember, or in case you have read, you must have noticed that Delhi Metro is saving more than 10 to 15% of electricity by using regenerative braking in their metro car. The liter of petrol costs about 70 rupees and the conventional scooter operates at about 70 to 100 rupees per 100 kilometer. For an electric two-wheeler with an electric price of around 3 to 6 rupees per unit, it would cost around 10 to 30 rupees per 100 kilometer, very cheap, which is significantly lower. So Bloomberg New Energy Finance estimates that the total cost of owning and operating electric two-wheeler by 2020 would be around 2 rupees per kilometer, which is on par with the petrol vehicle. So you buy a petrol vehicle, you buy electric vehicle. If you take the cost of total running, say both the two-wheeler run for a lakh kilometer. So overall operating cost, total cost, whatever you incur on their servicing, on their repair, changing the battery, or in case of petrol bike, changing the spares, their services and everything. And per hour operating cost, everything if you include, it will come out to be 2 rupee per kilometer. And it is same for the both type of vehicle, either petrol or electric vehicle. So that means these are quite favorable. So you just need to improve infrastructure and probably people will start shifting to electric vehicle. But then what are limitations? The first limitation, lithium ion batteries cost over 10,000 for every kilowatt hour. And you need 3 to 4 or around 4 to 5 for 100 kilometers per cycle of charging, 100 kilometers running per cycle of charging. So that would cost around 40 to 50,000 rupees, and which is at par with the price of retail price of petrol two wheeler. So if we could match that, and if we could bring that price at par with the price of normal petrol scooter, people would think about going for electric vehicle. Now let's try to see what are the other challenges. So these are basically 50-50 thing. The second challenge remains, which is related to refilling the tank of the electric scooter, that is the charging. This requires an electric scooter battery to be charged, and it can take of the order of an hour or more today. So if it is totally discharged, it will take at least an hour, and that is that's a limiting factor. The slow charging time of lithium ion batteries remains a frustration for many cell phone users, and the same issue persists with electric scooter, because lithium ion battery is used in your mobile phone. So lithium ion batteries today cannot be charged safely at a faster rate, and that is the first, in my opinion, is the first limitation. This is a 50-50 case, because the prices are going to be the same by 2020. And the second hurdle is where one should go to charge an electric scooter. Charging infrastructure is sparse today, but there is a strong commitment to improving this. An open question remains on where to strategically place the charger such that it can lead to widespread use and adoption. I personally, this is quite an interesting point, that you don't have charging station. Now say tomorrow there are charging stations. Still, if somebody's scooter gets discharged, what exactly should it do? Should that person do? In my opinion, one should, think about, giving small, rechargeable battery on loan, like a gas cylinder. You hire it, you go to the next station, and you give it back. So maybe 0.5 kilowatt hour battery. So you hire at one place, you go for say 5-7 kilometers to reach to your place, and then you submit to get your money back. This can be used as support, so that people tend to go for this kind of scooters. Now what is the future? Now that's what the author is saying, that future is with EV. In the recent interim budget in 2019, the then Finance Minister Piyush Goyal stressed on the need to switch to EVs powered by renewable to reduce oil imports and combat climate change. The electrification success story in India hinges on electrifying two-wheelers, which will require lowering cost of lithium-ion battery, increasing charging speed and improving charging infrastructure. Three points are covered here. So this is all we had for today. Thank you very much.